All right, now we can delve into the energy currency molecule of the cell, adenosine triphosphate, ATP. And this molecule has high energy phosphate bonds, as we will see, that are based on its structure. And we know that ATP, we've covered this already earlier in the class, is a five-carbon sugar. It has a five-carbon sugar, ribose, in it. It has a nitrogenous base in this adenine, and there are three phosphates as part of this molecule. So here's the structure. Here it is in diagram, and here it is in space fill. So here's our adenine, our nitrogenous base. Here is our ribose sugar, and then here are our three phosphate groups. ATP is a precursor for RNA polymerization. It's a monomer in RNA, in the RNA polymer. And to add ATP to a growing RNA chain, we cut off two of these phosphate groups. And then this phosphate becomes part of the sugar phosphate backbone of RNA. But right now we're not considering ATP as a precursor to DNA, or to RNA rather. We are considering it as the energy currency molecule of the cell, and that it is. And the reason that it is that these phosphate groups have highly negatively charged oxygens on them, and those negatively charged oxygens repel each other. And so by cleaving off one or possibly two phosphates from ATP, that is a reaction that releases energy. These are called high energy bonds. We call them high energy bonds, not really because the bond contains inordinately high energy, but rather because there is a loss of free energy when we get rid of the repellent charge that these oxygens have by cleaving off one phosphate or possibly two phosphates. So if we cleave off one phosphate, we're left with ADP, adenosine diphosphate, and if we cleave off two phosphates, we're left with AMP, adenosine monophosphate. And that, as I've said, can provide energy to drive biochemical reactions. That's why ATP is the energy currency molecule of the cell. And that this is text that goes over what I've just said, so you can pause this here if you want to read this. And we talk about energy release when we cleave those high energy phosphate bonds. This is our reaction when we're losing one phosphate. We call that an inorganic phosphate because it's no longer attached to an organic molecule. So ATP yields ADP plus inorganic phosphate. ADP is adenosine diphosphate, and that's inorganic phosphate. This reaction is reversible, that in that if we put energy in, we can add a phosphate to ADP to yield ATP. So let's look at this. If we are hydrolyzing ATP to cause the release of an inorganic phosphate, that releases energy. And this is an exergonic reaction. Energy is released. And that energy release can be used to fuel, to drive endergonic reactions that require energy. So for example, energy that released from exergonic reactions can add a phosphate to ADP to form ATP. This is an endergonic reaction, but it's being fueled by energy from exergonic reactions. And we've just talked about this, so you can read this at your leisure. Now back to enzymes as catalysts. Enzymes are biochemical catalysts, and most reactions are, most biochemical reactions are catalyzed by enzymes. There are some non-enzyme catalysts, but most of the catalysts are enzymes. And enzymes are proteins. And proteins here are, the enzymatic activity is to lower the activation energy required for a reaction, as we've already discussed. That's what catalysts do. And catalysts are not changed or consumed by the reaction. So if we have a biochemical reaction here, let's say A plus B, this is a reversible reaction, C plus D. This is catalyzed by an enzyme. An enzyme lowers the activation energy required for this reaction to proceed. So this could be, look at energy here, and we look at reactants and products, products and reactants. So this would have, this reaction would have a negative delta G. We'd have a negative delta G here. It would be a spontaneous reaction, but as we've seen, even for spontaneous reactions, there is an activation energy to get it going. And what the what enzymes do are lowering that activation energy. Enzyme catalysts, any catalyst does that. In this case, we're talking about enzyme catalysts. But the catalyst is not used up in this reaction. So an enzyme molecule that promotes this reaction, it's neither a reactant. These are the reactants, and these are the products. The enzyme is neither a reactant nor a product, and so it does not get used up or consumed by the process and is available to run many more of these reactions. So what the enzymes do, how do enzymes lower the activation energy for a particular reaction? They interact with the substrates, with the reactants. And so they engage a substrate that will undergo a change as part of the biochemical reaction. And they do so in an active site. The active site is the substrate binding site for the enzyme. And often that binding of a substrate to an enzyme will induce a change in the conformation of the enzyme, of the protein. We call that an induced fit. We have an induced fit here between the molecules. So it's not just like sticking a key into a keyhole. When the key goes in, the lock kind of changes its conformation to fit tightly around the key, in this case, the substrate. So let's look at that. Here's an enzyme, and here's a substrate, and here is the active site which binds that substrate. And then the induced fit is when there's some conformational change in the protein. In this case, we have an infolding of these wings out here, if you will, to enclose the substrate in a tight binding situation. Now, enzymes can lower the activation energy by providing, in its active site, a stereochemical environment that promotes the particular biochemical reaction underway. Or it can bring reactants into close proximity so that one atom on one of the reactants can attack another atom on another one of the reactants to promote the biochemical reaction. So enzymes can lower the activation energy by creating the right stereochemical environment for substrates to bind and therefore undergo a change that is the biochemical reaction. And let's look at this. So here's sucrose, a disaccharide bound to an enzyme, sucrase, and sucrase catalyzes the hydrolysis of sucrose into glucose and fructose, two monosaccharides, and then the products are released and we have free enzyme ready to engage in another round of catalysis. So enzymes are not used up in the process. They're continually, can be used over and over again. Now many enzymes are part of enzyme complexes. So if we have a biochemical pathway, for example. So let's say compound A is converted to compound B, which is converted to compound C, which is compounded to D rather, and then that's converted to E, and so on. And each one of these steps might be catalyzed by an enzyme, enzyme 1, enzyme 2, enzyme 3, enzyme 4. It's often what will happen is that you will have these enzymes in some type of complex. So enzyme 1, enzyme 2, enzyme 3, enzyme 4, say. So these enzymes are part of a multi-enzyme complex, and that offers certain advantages for the efficiency, in terms of the efficiency of the biochemical pathway. So for example, the product of one reaction can be directly delivered to the next enzyme if they're part of the same complex. So that can speed up the next step of the reaction. A multi-enzyme complex eliminates the possibility of unwanted side reactions because the product of one reaction isn't free to diffuse out and go somewhere and possibly be modified. So it's right there where it's ready for the next step of the of catalysis, which will promote the next step of the biochemical pathway. And you can control then all of the reactions in a biochemical pathway as a single unit. So often, not always, enzymes can exist in multi-enzyme complexes, which have quaternary structure because you're bringing in different proteins as part of a large assemblage. Now, not all enzymes are proteins. RNA, in fact, ribonucleic acid, RNA, can actually catalyze reactions. And that is because RNA is capable of folding into globular shapes like proteins do in a way. And those globular shapes can provide active sites that can catalyze certain biochemical reactions. And that wasn't known for a long time. The discoverer of that actually won the Nobel Prize. His name is Thomas Cech, and he was at the University of Colorado Boulder at the time. And so we call RNA catalysts, RNAs that have catalytic activity, not just informational storage capability, but catalytic activity. We call those ribozymes, like enzymes. This is a ribozyme, which is an RNA catalyst. And the ribosome actually is a ribozyme because there are catalytic RNAs as part of the structure of the ribosome. Some of the RNAs, in other words, are not just structural, they are actually catalytic in terms of promoting protein synthesis inside the ribosome. Now, enzymes are affected by the environment that they exist in. And any factor that affects an enzyme's three-dimensional shape can change its function. In protein biology, in the structural biology of proteins, the structure of a molecule, the structure of a protein is essential to its function. It dictates, for example, in an enzyme, how the active site interacts with substrate. A three-dimensional shape can influence how the enzyme interacts with other proteins. Function follows form in protein structure. And so any factors that change the shape, the tertiary structure of a protein, can alter its function. pH, temperature, regulatory molecules can alter the shape of a protein and therefore can affect its catalytic activity if it's an enzyme. Temperature. Most enzymes have a catalytic optimal temperature. So if you were to plot activity of an enzyme, the ability of it to conduct its biochemical reaction versus temperature, often proteins will have an optimum, most proteins have an optimum temperature at which their activity is maximized. Anything below that or above that, the enzyme is affected. And at very high temperatures, when you move into the high temperature range, you can take a protein that has a three-dimensional shape and you can denature that. You can break all the hydrogen bonds and salt bridges so that you denature a protein. Unfolding a protein is called denaturing. We denature a protein when we unfold it. And at high temperatures, that can happen. But at even temperatures slightly above the optimum, the activity of the enzyme is lowered. So there's usually a temperature optimum for protein, for enzymes. And next we'll pick up with the effect of pH on three-dimensional shape of enzymes, and therefore the effect of pH on enzymatic activity.